Hi, welcome back to Mysteries Channeled. Last week, I started reading from the Children of Odin, a book written in 1920. It is of the Northern mythology. I'm going to read the next chapter or two, depending on how far time goes. All right. Iduna and her apples and how Loki put the gods in danger. In Asgard, there was a garden, and in that garden, there grew a tree, and on that tree grew shining apples. Thou knowest, O well-loved one, that every day that passes makes us older and brings us to that day when we will be bent and feeble, gray-headed and weak-eyed. But those shining apples that grew in Asgard, they who ate of them every day grew never a day older, for the eating of the apples kept old age away. Iduna the goddess tended the tree on which the shining apples grew. None would grow on the tree unless she was there to tend it. No one but Iduna might pluck the shining apples. Each morning she plucked them and left them in her basket, and every day the gods and the goddesses came to her garden that they might eat the shining apples and so stay young forever. Iduna never went away from her garden. All day and every day she stayed in the garden or in the golden house beside it. And all day and every day she listened to Bragi, her husband, tell a story that never had an end. Ah, but a time came when Iduna and her apples were lost to Asgard, and the gods and the goddesses felt old age approach them. How all that happened shall be told to thee, O well-beloved. Odin, the father of the gods, often went into the land of men to watch over their doings. Once he took Loki with him, Loki the doer of good and the doer of evil. For a time, they went traveling through the world of men. At last they came near Jotunheim, the realm of the giants. It was a bleak and empty region. There were no growing things there, not even trees with berries. There were no birds, there were no animals. As Odin, the father of the gods, and Loki, the doer of good and the doer of evil, went through this region, hunger came upon them. But in the land around, they saw nothing they could eat. Loki, running here and running there, came at last upon a herd of wild cattle. Creeping up on them, he caught hold of a young bull and killed him. He then cut the flesh up into strips of meat. He lighted a fire and put the meat onto spits to roast. While the meat was cooking, Odin, the father of the gods, a little way off, sat thinking on the things he had seen in the world of men. Loki made himself busy putting more and more logs on the fire, and at last he called to Odin, and the father of the gods came and sat down near the fire to eat the meal. But when the meat was taken off the cooking spits, and when Odin went to cut it, he found that it was still raw. He smiled at Loki for thinking the meat was cooked, and Loki, troubled that he had made a mistake, put the meat back and put more logs on the fire. Again, Loki took the meat off the cooking spits and called Odin to the meal. Odin, when he took the meat that Loki brought him, found that it was raw, as if it had never been put on the fire. "Is this a trick of yours, Loki?" he asked. Loki was so angry at the meat being uncooked that Odin saw he was playing no tricks. In his hunger, he raged at the meat and he raged at the fire. Again, he put the meat on the cooking spits, put more logs on the fire. Every hour, he would take up the meat, sure that it was now well cooked, and every time he took it off, Odin would find that the meat was still as raw as the first time they took it off the fire. Now, Odin knew that this must be under some enchantment by the giants. He stood up and went on his way, hungry but strong. Loki, however, he would not leave the meat that he had put back on the fire. He would make it be cooked, he declared, and he would not leave that place hungry. The dawn came and he took up the meat again. As he was lifting it off the fire, he heard a whirr of wings above his head. Looking up, he saw a mighty eagle, the largest eagle that ever appeared in the sky. The eagle circled around and came above Loki's head. "Can't you cook thy food?" the eagle screamed to him. "I cannot cook it," said Loki. "I will cook it for thee if you'll give me a share," screamed the eagle. "Come then and cook it for me," said Loki. The eagle circled around until he was above the fire. Then, flapping his great wings over it, he made the fire blaze and blaze. A heat that Loki had never felt before came from the burning logs. In a minute, he drew the meat from the spits and found that it was all well cooked. "My share, my share, my share," the eagle screamed at him. He flew down and seized on a large piece of meat and instantly devoured it. He seized on another piece. Piece after piece he devoured until it looked as if Loki would be left with no meat for his meal. As the eagle seized on the last piece, Loki became angry indeed. Taking up the spit on which the meat had been cooked, he struck the eagle. There was a clang as if he had struck some hard metal. The wood of the spit did not come away. It struck the breast of the eagle, but Loki did not let go and held on to the spit. Suddenly, the eagle rose up in the air. Loki, who held on to the spit, was fastened to the eagle's breast. It was drawing him up. Before he knew what happened, Loki was miles and miles in the air, and the eagle was flying with him toward Jotunheim, the realm of the giants. And the eagle was screaming out, "Loki, friend Loki, I have thee at last. It was you who cheated my brother of the reward for building the wall around Asgard. But Loki, I have you at last. Know that Thiassi the giant has captured you, O Loki, most cunning of the dwellers in Asgard." Thus the eagle screamed as he went flying with Loki toward Jotunheim, the realm of the giants. They passed over the rivers and divides Jotunheim from Midgard, the world of the men, and now Loki saw a terrible place beneath him, a land of ice and rock. Great mountains were there, were they lighted by neither sun nor moon, but columns of fire, thrown up now and again through the cracks in the earth or out of the peaks of the mountains. Over a great iceberg, the eagle hovered. Suddenly, he shook the spit from his breast, and Loki fell down onto the ice. The eagle screamed out at him, "You are in my power at last, you most cunning of the dwellers in Asgard." The eagle left Loki there and flew within a crack in the mountain. Miserable indeed was Loki upon the iceberg. The cold was deadly. He could not die there, for he was one of the dwellers in Asgard, and death might not come for him that way. He might not die, but he felt bound to that iceberg with chains of cold. After a day, his captor came to him, not as an eagle this time, but in his own form, Thiassi the giant. "Would you leave the iceberg, Loki," he said, "and return to your pleasant place in Asgard? Do you delight in Asgard, although only by half of you belongs to the gods? Your father, Loki, was the wind giant." "Oh, that I might leave this iceberg," Loki said, with tears freezing on his face. "You may leave it when you show yourself ready to pay your ransom," said Thiassi. "You will have to get me the shining apples that Iduna keeps in her basket." "I cannot get Iduna's apples for you, Thiassi," said Loki. "Then stay upon the iceberg," said Thiassi the giant. He went away and left Loki there with the terrible winds buffeting him like blows of a hammer. Then Thiassi returned again and spoke to him about his ransom. Loki said, "There is no way of getting the shining apples from Iduna." "Oh, there must be some way, O cunning Loki," said the giant. "Iduna, although she guards well shining apples, is simple-minded," said Loki. "It may be that I shall be able to get her to go outside the wall of Asgard. If she goes, she will bring her shining apples with her, for she never lets them out of her hand except when she gives them to the gods and the goddesses to eat." "Make it so she goes beyond the wall of Asgard," said the giant. "If she goes outside the wall, then I shall get the apples from her. Swear by the world tree that you will lure Iduna beyond the wall of Asgard. Swear it, Loki, and I shall let thee go." "I swear it by Yggdrasil, the world tree, that I will lure Iduna beyond the wall of Asgard if you will take me off this iceberg," said Loki. Then Thiassi changed himself into a mighty eagle, and taking Loki into his talons, he flew him over the stream of the divides of Jotunheim and the realm of giants in Midgard, the world of men. He left Loki on the ground in Midgard, and Loki then went on his way to Asgard. Now Odin had already returned, and he had told the dwellers in Asgard of Loki's attempt to cook the enchanted meat. All laughed to think that Loki had been left hungry for all of his cunning. Then, when he came to Asgard looking so famished, they thought it was because Loki had nothing to eat. They laughed at him more and more. But they brought him to the feast hall, and they gave him the best food with wine out of Odin's wine cup. When the feast was over, the dwellers in Asgard went to Iduna's garden, as was their wont. There sat Iduna in the garden in the golden house that opened onto her garden. Had she been in the world of men, everyone who saw her would have remembered their own innocence, seeing one who was so fair and so good. She had eyes as blue as the blue sky, and she smiled as if she had been remembering lovely things she had seen or heard. The basket of shining apples was beside her. To each god and goddess, Iduna gave a shining apple. Each one ate the apple given, rejoicing to think that they would never become a day older. Then Odin, the father of the gods, said the runes that were always said in praise of Iduna, and the dwellers in Asgard went out of Iduna's garden, each one going to his or her own shining house. All went except Loki, the doer of good and the doer of evil. Loki sat in the garden, watching fair and simple Iduna. After a while, she spoke to him then, and she said, "Why do you still stay here, Loki?" "To look well on your apples," Loki said. "I am wondering if the apples I saw yesterday are really as shining as the apples that are in your basket." "There are no apples in the world as shining as mine," said Iduna. "The apples I saw were more shining," said Loki. "Aye, and they smelt better too, Iduna." Iduna was troubled at what Loki, whom she deemed so wise, told her. Her eyes filled with tears that there might be more shiny apples in the world than hers. "Oh, Loki," she said, "it cannot be. No apples are more shining, and none smell so sweet as the apples I pluck off the tree in my garden." "Go then and see," said Loki. "Just outside Asgard is a tree that has the apples I saw." "You, Iduna, you never leave your garden. You do not know what grows in the world. Go outside of Asgard and go see." "I will, Loki," said Iduna, fair and simple. Iduna went outside of Asgard. She went to the place that Loki had told her that the apples grew. But as she looked this way and that, Iduna heard a whirr of wings above her. Looking up, she saw a mighty eagle, the largest eagle that had ever appeared in the sky. She drew back towards the gate of Asgard. Then the great eagle swooped down. Iduna felt herself lift up, and then she was carried away from Asgard, away, 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 over Midgard where the men lived, away towards the rocks and snow of Jotunheim. Across the river that flows between the world of men and the realm of giants, Iduna was born. Then the eagle flew into a cleft in the mountain, and Iduna was left in a cavernous hall lighted up by columns of fire that burst up from the earth. The eagle loosened his grips on Iduna, and she sank down on the ground of the cavern. The wings and the feathers fell from him, and she saw her captor as a terrible giant. "Oh, why have you carried me off from Asgard and brought me to this place?" Iduna cried. "That I might eat your shining apples, Iduna," said Thiassi the giant. "That will never be. For I will not give them to you," said Iduna. "Give me the apples to eat, and I shall carry you back to Asgard." "No, no, that cannot be. I have been trusted with the shining apples that I might give them to the gods only." "Then I shall take the apples from you," Thiassi the giant said. He took the basket out of her hands and he opened it. But when he touched the apples, they shriveled under his hands. He left them in the basket and he set the basket down, for he knew now that the apples would be no good to him unless Iduna gave them to him with her own hands. "You must stay with me here until you give me the shining apples," he said to her. Then was poor Iduna frightened. She was frightened of the strange cave and frightened of the fire that kept bursting up out of the earth, and she was frightened of the terrible giant. Above all, she was frightened to think of the evil that would fall upon the dwellers in Asgard if she were not there to give them the shining apples to eat. The giant came to her again, but still Iduna would not give him the shining apples. And there in the cave she stayed, the giant troubling her every day. And she grew more and more fearful as she saw in her dreams the dwellers in Asgard go to her garden, go there, and not being given the shiny apples, feel and see a change coming over themselves and over each other. It was as Iduna saw it in her dreams. Every day the dwellers in Asgard went to her garden. Odin and Thor, Hodar and Baldur, Tyr and Heimdall, Vidar and Vali, with Frigga, Freya, Nanna, and Sif. There was no one to pluck the apples off the tree, and a change began to come over the gods and goddesses. They no longer walked lightly, their shoulders became bent, their eyes no longer were as bright as dewdrops, and when they looked upon one another, they saw the change. Age was coming upon the dwellers in Asgard. They knew that the time would come when Frigga would be gray and old, when Sif's golden hair would fade, and when Odin would no longer have his clear wisdom, and when Thor would not have strength enough to raise and fling his thunderbolts. And the dwellers in Asgard were saddened by this knowledge, and it seemed to them that all the brightness had gone from their shining city. Where was Iduna with those apples? Where was Iduna whose apples would give back youth and strength and beauty to the dwellers in Asgard? The gods had searched for her through the world of men. No trace of her did they find. But now Odin, searching through his wisdom, saw a means to get knowledge of where Iduna was hidden. He summoned his two ravens, Huginn and Munin, his two ravens that flew through the earth and through the realm of the giants, and that knew all things that were past and all things that were to come. He summoned Huginn and Munin, and they came. And one sat on his right shoulder and the other sat on his left shoulder, and they told him deep secrets. They told him of Thiassi and his desire for the shining apples that the dwellers in Asgard ate, and of Loki's deception of Iduna, the fair and simple. What Odin learnt from his ravens was told to the council of the gods. Then Thor, the strong, went to Loki and laid hands upon him. When Loki found himself in the grip of the strong god, he said, "What would you do with me, O Thor? I would hurl you into a chasm in the ground and strike you with my thunder," said the strong god. "It was you who led Iduna out of Asgard." "Oh, Thor," said Loki, "do not crush me with your thunder. Let me stay in Asgard. I will strive to win Iduna back." "The judgment of the gods," said Thor, "is that you, the cunning one, should go to Jotunheim and by your craft win Iduna back from the giants. Go, or else I shall hurl you into a chasm and crush you with my thunder." "I will go," said Loki. From Frigga, the wife of Odin, Loki borrowed the dress of a falcon feathers that she owned. He clad himself in it and flew to Jotunheim in the form of a falcon. He searched through Jotunheim until he found Thiassi's daughter, Skadi. He flew before Skadi and let the giant maid catch him and hold him as a pet. One day, the giant maid carried him into the cave where Iduna the Fair and Simple was held. When Loki saw Iduna there, he knew that part of his quest was ended. Now he had to get Iduna out of Jotunheim and away to Asgard. He stayed no more with the giant maid, but flew up into the high rocks of the cavern. Skadi wept for the flight of her pet, but she ceased to search and call for him and went away from the cave. Then Loki, the doer of good and the doer of evil, flew to where Iduna was sitting and spoke to her. Iduna, when she knew that one of the dwellers of Asgard was near, wept with joy. Loki told her what she was to do. By the power of a spell that was given to him, he was able to change her in the form of a sparrow. But before she did this, she took the shining apples out of the basket and flung them into places where the giants would never find them. Skadi, coming back to the cave, saw the falcon fly out with the sparrow beside him. She cried to her father, and the giant knew that the falcon was Loki and the sparrow was Iduna. He changed himself into the form of the mighty eagle. By this time, sparrow and falcon were out of sight, but Thiassi, knowing that he could make better flight than they, flew toward Asgard. Soon he saw them. They flew with all the power they had, but the great wings of the eagle brought them nearer and nearer to them. The dwellers in Asgard, standing on the wall, saw the falcon and the sparrow and the great eagle pursuing them. They knew who they were, Loki and Iduna, with Thiassi in pursuit. As they watched the eagle winging nearer and nearer, the dwellers in Asgard were fearful that the falcon and the sparrow would be caught upon and that Iduna would be taken again by Thiassi. They lighted great fires upon the wall, knowing that Loki would find a way through the fires, bringing Iduna with him, but Thiassi would not find a way. The falcon and the sparrow flew towards the fires. Loki went through the flames and brought Iduna with him. And Thiassi, coming up to the flames and finding no way to go through, beat his wings against the flames. He fell down from the wall and death came to him afterwards. He fell down from the wall and the death that came to him afterwards was laid to Loki. Thus was Iduna back to Asgard. Once again, she sat in the golden house that opened to her garden. Once again, she plucked the shining apples off the tree she tended. And once again, she gave them to the dwellers in Asgard. And the dwellers in Asgard walked away lightly again. Brightness came to their eyes and in their cheeks, and age no more approached them. Youth came back. Light and joy were again in Asgard. All right, this was a long chapter, so I'm going to end there. Thanks for watching, and you guys have yourselves a very great day.